Day America. Stand by for news.
He just loves that.
I'm Jack Rickard, and this is another stunning episode of Electric Vehicle Television, EVTV. This is my cohort and partner in crime, Brian Noto.
Hey, it's good to be here on a great Friday in Cape Girardeau, Missouri.
I love October.
Isn't it nice?
It's October. Crisp, it's bright. Oh, God.
Thank God.
And this is my month.
Yeah, July, August, whew. Except for the show, except for the
EVCON. It's a great, sunny, crisp day to get on the internet and see what's on the internet-osphere.
Oh, okay. Well, we have
what
all kinds.
What did you find?
Well, we had some interesting things. Cadillac, you know, has been working on the ELR. Mm-hmm. Their Volt, kind of. I guess a real upscale Volt. Mm-hmm. Well, they decided to make it very upscale in terms of pricing. I hope it's got a nice interior because it's $75,999. For the Cadillac ELR.
Man, I'm glad it's not $76,000.
Well, it is if you add the $9.95 destination fee.
Oh, there's a $9.95 destination fee. Underbody protection, special dealer prep.
Curb feelers.
Curb feelers.
Hubcaps.
Well, there you have it. No, these guys are lost, dazed, and confused. This is what they should have come out with instead of the Volt.
Right, originally. Absolutely.
And they just, they continue to amaze. I'm left in awe of this corporation.
They may be dyslexic.
They are actually completely stupid. Now, this will, in spite of all that, this will work.
It's going to work. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. It's going to open up the high-end market into that vehicle.
Of course.
Yeah.
There's a lot of people very loyal to General Motors products. They weren't going to buy a Volt or be seen in a Volt.
No, they want that Cadillac shield.
You bet. Yeah. And I'm a Cadillac driver myself. I like it pretty well. And they drive better electric.
And, yeah, that's right.
there's like one of us in a row that knows.
Yes, exactly.
Huh? That would be moi.
Yeah, yeah.
And let me tell you, I think that's pretty attractive. $76,000, $77,000. You know, that's going to be a tough sell.
Yeah.
It's pretty steep. You know, I could have seen that at 66 or 67. I think I only paid 59 for my EXT new.
2008,
76
right?
76 is pretty
a lot.
Rich,
that's a lot.
But
yeah.
You know, it may sell more than the Volt does.
Yes.
And what are they going to do if they're selling 1,500 Volts and 2,000 ELRs?
Oh, man.
Now, what's that going to tell them?
Yeah, that they should have done the luxury car.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Well, it could happen that way.
Yeah.
I'm not lost, dazed, and confused like General Motors. This is how early adopter markets behave.
Right.
Show me something I want, not something I need. I don't need an electric car. I know this because I've never had one.
Yeah, right, exactly.
Show me right. One I'll want.
That's right.
And a Cadillac sedan, maybe.
Yeah, and a nice looking car.
I tell you what, I would have gone for the Volt if they'd have built the Volt that they showed me.
Yeah, the more aggressive looking kind of Camaro-esque.
It was kind of a tight looking little car.
Yeah.
And they converted that to a mommy wagon, just morphed it.
Yeah.
And I just ain't at a place in life where I go to a lot of soccer games, guys. I'm sorry. It's just not a happening thing. And I mean, face it, what's driving this market is guys and guys like me.
Yeah.
I mean, that's if you can't make me want it, it's not going to sell. I'm sorry.
Yeah, not in the early adopter market.
So I would suspect that they'll sell as many ELRs as they do Volts. And what are they going to do with that information? Because it does not fit their worldview of elasticity of price and volume and so forth. But it just is what it is.
Probably going to work that way. Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's probably going to work
that way. I think it'll be a nice car.
Yes. Can't wait to actually see one in person.
Yep.
Yeah. You know what? I thought that the government was shut down.
Mm-hmm.
And they've been crowing about the government being shut down. However, apparently it's not that shut down, because they were able to put out a $20 million electric pickup truck and van project with, I think, the South Coast Air Quality Management District in Southern California, and award it to Via Motors. Mm-hmm. So there's going to be some pickup trucks out there, and they're going to test them and have some real-time reporting, I guess, so they can really see what a fleet of electric vehicles does in the real world.
An interesting and ongoing variation in the quest for stupid money and fleet truck sales. And God love them, I hope it works great.
I know, that's right.
But don't get me started on the government. I heard last night that the government is exactly 17% shut down.
Oh.
And what is happening is Barack Obama directly is managing the shutdown, trying to find the things most visible and most hurtful to the American people, and going ahead and funding all the stuff he needs to have run.
All the stuff we need to have.
And he's very selective about it. Technically, that's treason, and the penalty, and during time of war, which we're still at war, is death by hanging. And I would advocate that at this point.
We can have to ask Patrick.
I think he's a traitor to the United States of America. Not just not a good president, but a traitor. What could I do to make that more clear?
Let's lighten up a little bit here.
Yeah, whoa. Don't get me started on that shit.
Should we read the obituaries or something?
World War II veterans from a memorial.
Yeah, but they stormed it, man. It was like the beaches of Omaha Beach, man.
And a storm his ass. Pansy.
Let's see. A company that I really hadn't heard too much about, a car charging group, I guess, that owns some charging stations, a lot of in parking garages in New York City, and I think maybe a couple out of the country and things, bought whatever was left of Ecotality's Blink assets. So I guess the main focus there was to keep that network up and running. But it didn't disclose the price. I don't know how much.
I heard $3.3 million,
okay,
which is a pittance. Yeah, and the concept of keeping the network up and running is somewhat dubious, as the Blink network, as it was known, was largely on the blink.
Never was up too much.
And so a lot of complaints about it, which led to their demise. So there's always a suitor for everything at some price.
At some price, yeah. And I guess the $3.3 million was kind of a fire sale, huh?
I guess.
Because they would have gotten hundreds of millions, I suppose.
I would imagine they've got $3.3 million worth of copper.
Yeah, exactly.
They can salvage at the local
exactly
metals.
Yeah, if someone doesn't take all the plugs, huh?
Yeah, right. Wow. They don't cut all the plugs
beat them
off
to
and
it.
Turn it in before they do.
That's right. Let's see. Well, you know, we always end up talking about solar and Tesla and stuff like that, and it's all in the news again.
Mm-hmm,
mm-hmm. It's Solar City, just to give off a little off subject a little bit. I did. Their stock apparently today took a 20% increase.
Mm-hmm.
I guess it was trading at 38 or something, got up to almost $47 at one point.
Yeah, Warren Buffett Rickard here has again been trading in and out of Solar City quietly for months. And I missed the train today.
Were you out today?
I was out for like 10 minutes, and boom, they went from $38 to $47. Solar City is the other end of the triumvirate of Elon Musk's companies.
Yes.
It's a very interesting play in that they largely finance solar installations. They claim to be making them, and they do. But in a kind of a different way, they install it on your roof, and you don't pay anything.
Yeah, mostly residential stuff. They don't do the big solar farms.
They're
things.
Getting
yeah.
where they're doing more of the big stuff. Are That's they? The
okay.
change.
Okay.
But what they've been doing is lining up financing, and like Goldman Sachs is in for $500 million.
Oh, really?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, man. I didn't know that.
And they go to people, and it's a neat deal. Really, mm-hmm. when you think about it, they'll come put solar on your roof, and it doesn't cost you anything. They take the tax credit. You don't get it.
Okay, all right.
And you agreed to buy electricity from them for 20 years at a rate less than, but not much less than, the local utility.
Okay, from the array that's on your roof.
That's right.
Okay, interesting. I didn't realize that.
A couple things happen.
Yeah.
They get the tax credit.
Yes.
You are solar.
Yes.
But a lot of areas, particularly California, they have rate increases every year. You've just locked in your rate partially for 20 years.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense as the homeowner, yeah.
And that gets better every year. And the value of your home goes up because you've got solar.
You've got the solar array. Nice. Yeah, that is a good play. Yeah, absolutely. For everybody.
The oddity of the company is they can never make a profit. If you ever see them actually become profitable, it means they have declining sales and are going bad.
Oh, yes. Oh, no. They keep doing new installations.
Uh-huh. It's kind of almost a Ponzi scheme.
Yeah, yeah, they keep doing new installations.
But it's building an ever-increasing trail of recurring revenue.
Yes, yes, right. Yeah.
Getting more valuable.
Yeah.
The customers are more likely to hang with you because they keep doing better against the local utility rates all the time.
Right, and like you said, locked in. Yeah.
And they're locked in for 20 years. The so this recurring revenue stream, they wind up being a utility company, a solar utility company.
Right, really.
I mean, what number of roofs would they have to be considered a solar utility company?
Right, because they're selling the power back to you, really, or to you.
Right.
Yeah.
No, they sell power to you.
I didn't realize that. Interesting.
And they use your roof for their plant.
Yeah.
But it costs you nothing to install it.
It's pretty cool. That's a pretty nice incentive for the homeowner. Yeah.
It works dramatically well when interest rates are 0%.
Right.
Now, if they go to 15%, this may not work quite as well.
Yes. That's right.
That's the one booger in the stock, is it's a bet that we're going to have low interest rates like Japan for 10 years or 20 years or something as interest rates go up. But on the other hand, if inflation kicks in, the value of their installed plant
goes up. Yeah.
Goes up.
Yeah.
And so
interesting.
It's a very interesting company. And I think this is Elon Musk's brother, cousin, something or other.
Yes.
And he kind of gave him this idea of how to do solar, and it's working out very well.
Yeah, they're expecting next year, I guess, to double. They're going to deploy 278 megawatts this year and are expecting to do about 500 megawatts next year.
I talked about this, two months ago? I actually put up charts of the solar, the history of it from the 70s until recently. 2011, they installed as much solar as had been installed up to that point.
Wow.
And in 2012, they installed as much solar as had been installed up to that point, plus 2011.
Plus the 2011 banner.
And so the curve went from almost flat to almost vertical in the last 2 years.
Yeah, that's amazing.
And it's a function of the falling price of solar cells. This is going to get to be a huge thing in the next year or two, and I'm very uncomfortable mentioning that since someone has said that every day for the last 35 years.
That's right.
It's like the boy who cried wolf. Eventually there is such a thing as a wolf.
That's right. You'll run across a wolf.
And we are there on the solar thing. I'm almost dancing, peeing my pants over a discovery this week on eBay of a new sun power panel. And I bought one of them at a ridiculously high price, $576 for a 200-watt panel.
That is expensive.
I've since got a line on them through Alibaba into China. We're going to have them in the store. We're going into solar panel sales. We're going to have them for you. All you got to do is like buy 100 of them.
Okay.
This keeps getting to be more of a capital business all the time. However, we'll be able to offer them for like 320 or something.
Instead of almost
576.
Yeah, wow, okay.
This panel is remarkable in a couple of different ways. It's 51 inches long and 33 inches wide, which is not very remarkable. It's 3 millimeters thick.
Really?
You can bend it, and it weighs 6 pounds.
That's amazing.
That's amazing.
That's the amazing part. Wow.
I see it, and actually the manufacturers see it, as the primary application is boats. And electric boats particularly. Ooh,
wouldn't that be something? Electric boats. Imagine that.
200 watts, 6 pounds, 51 by 31. You could put a roof on a pontoon boat, say 13 feet long, 8.5 feet wide, and put 10 of them up there for 1,800 watts. 5 hour day.
Yeah, right, right.
You're at 9 kilowatt hours, which would be a third or a half of your pack
if you did
a solid, straight up electric boat. And that would be pretty cool.
Yes, that would be pretty cool. Yeah.
And you'd have 60 pounds of panels on the top of it.
Not bad. That's actually pretty encouraging.
And you can form it to curves.
Curve it, yeah.
It's not, you can't roll it up, but it's flexible. Not foldable.
Yeah, but flexible.
But it'll flex.
Yeah, that's
3 millimeter thick, kind of a plastic package, and 200 watts. Oh, 20% efficiency.
That's amazing.
That's the key.
That is really something.
And so we have actually awarded copper foil helmets to people who want to put solar panels on their cars and use it to charge the batteries. It just doesn't work. It probably, if you wanted to put, if you had a big car and a big roof, and you wanted to put one of these panels up there, let's see, it's about 16.5 volts and 11.5 amps fully loaded. So you could charge a 12-volt battery system quite ably with this one panel. And it's less than 5 feet long and less than 3 feet wide. It's conceivable.
Sure.
You're not going to charge your pack off of it, but you can charge your 12-volt system and get rid of the... as long as it's parked outside in the sun.
Yeah, as long as you're in the sun, absolutely.
Get rid of the bricked car concept.
Yes.
But I see it for pontoon boats and, you know, perhaps other boats that have large area. And they're lightweight. They're highly efficient, so smaller size actually makes a useful amount of power.
Yes.
And if you get up to even 600-800 watts, you know, 3 or 4 of these panels, that's a fairly significant amount of power, particularly if a boat's docked.
Sure. And they are a lot.
You're docked all week, you go out on a weekend, well, you're fully charged on everything by then.
Yeah, by that time, yeah. You're ready to go.
And so this all of a sudden becomes viable at some level. So I think it's like a breakthrough.
No, it is. I can't wait to see it. Absolutely.
Mostly in packaging.
Yes.
So we're going to try to get a stock of those and sell them in the store because I think it's that going to be, I think everybody's going to want one of them to play with.
Yeah, exactly. See what it is. Exactly.
Just to fool around with it.
Yeah, exactly.
It's a mat the size of this table that'll charge 12-volt battery forever and use it at a useful rate.
Yeah, not just real trickly. Yeah, it's very useful.
So it's reached a threshold. This is, you know, one of these thresholds of viability that you cross where things go from being a science experiment to being useful. I've spoken of this in the past with regard to our batteries. I think this is that one of those thresholds on solar
with
panels.
With solar, yeah.
Now we're putting up plain old panels on our roof here, and they're much less expensive. And they'll last a long time, and I don't have any problem with that at all. This is for special applications.
Exactly. Yeah, brings solar to different.
And they're kind of like our applications.
Yes, yes.
And so, you know, I think it's a huge deal. I'm very excited about it.
Yes, I think so. I think so. Let's see, what else? Oh, well, Solar City, we were going to talk about one of the other of the three triumvirates of Elon Musk, Tesla. Mm-hmm. I think we talked about, was it last week? I think we talked about Tesla being the I think sold more cars than any manufacturer in Norway.
Mm-hmm.
I think right. For the month of September.
Mm-hmm.
Well, in Switzerland, Tesla has already sold in 2 months 111 Model S's. They were the largest selling car for September in terms of plug-in electric vehicles. And their competitors, the Renault Zoe, sells pretty good, 188 so far. Mm-hmm. Nissan Leaf, 149. But in terms of dollar volume, I got to imagine that the Tesla Model S in dollars at 111 is outsold everybody in dollar volume.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, and they're the largest selling plug-in car in Switzerland. So
this is anecdotally what's coming out of Europe is that Tesla's making the cut. And that brings up another topic. I don't want to turn this into an investment advisory club. I told you I'm not that good at it. I sold short at 192, covered at 187 or
something. Yeah.
And it dove to 164 on this ridiculous fire story. Which never did amount
to anything. It never did really amount to anything at all.
That's why I thought it would be a dip to maybe 185.
Yeah.
I really didn't think it would even do what it did. It's stupid money doing that. But, you know, it is a volatile stock. I took it as a buying opportunity on Seeking Alpha. A guy did an article talking about something that's very interesting, and I've known about it. I hadn't checked recently. But in the Tesla forums, the owners, and particularly the new owners, are sharing data. Oh. And the data they're sharing is their VIN number and their delivery dates. And they're making graphs.
Really?
And what it looks like right now is that Tesla is approaching 800 vehicle builds a week, and we could well be looking at a quarterly sale of 8,000 Tesla Model S's for the third quarter. Reportedly reporting on November 4th, these guys have never made a reporting date
right.
yet. They're always a week late.
That's right. Why start now? Huh?
So figure the 10th or 11th of November. Yeah. I'm not going to suggest what you should do because, like I say, I get beat as much as I win. Moi bought 100 contracts. December 21st, 225s, call options. What is that? And they were about $5 for Tesla at 225. A contract is for 100 shares. The $5 is a per share premium that you're paying for the right to then purchase on December 21st a share of Tesla for $225. Now, if it's $178 today, why would I want to do that? I'm going to pay $5 for the right to buy it at $225 on December 21st. And in fact, a contract is for 100 of those.
100 of those,
so yeah. I got to pay $500 for contract and 50,000 slick ones 400 contracts. Why would I want to do that?
Well, I would just think that you think the stock price is going to be above 225.
Actually, above 230 if I bought it at $5.
Yeah, that's right, another $5. That's right. Yeah.
If I could, if I could turn my $5 into the right to purchase at $235. Mm-hmm. Or at 230 when it's
higher than
235.
Yeah,
my $5 gets me another $5. That's 100% gain. It's actually more leverage than that. It's kind of a function of time. Yeah. If it went to that, let's say before December 21st, like November the 10th, when they announced, then there's still time left for it to go higher. So it's still a viable option with a time value to it.
Yes.
I bought some June 47s when it was $35 and at like a buck and a half.
Oh, yeah.
Sold them at $8, which I thought was a handsome profit.
Yes, sir.
And by June, they were $80
a piece. I remember.
I only left about $1.8 million on the table there. So talk about doing the right thing and then screwing it up anyway. That's my usual motif on so do as I say and then don't get out when I do.
That's right.
Hang on
a little longer, that's right.
And so that's if they announce 8,000 cars and any sort of progress, they do not have to meet Elon Musk's stated goal of 25% margin. All he has to do is move from where he was at toward that.
On the way, yes. Yeah.
And sell 8,000 cars with strong sales in Europe and a lot of happy talk about what might happen in China.
Sure.
And as I said, this stock could be $300 before the end of the year. Probably on December 22nd, after my options expire.
It'll go down, then it'll jump the next day.
Right. But
oh, well.
The thinking is usually pretty good. The execution, right. I get things right. A little messed up. But anyway, that's the situation. I mean, the other end of it is if the stock goes down instead of up, your $5 goes to a nickel, which is what my... October 19th, Solar City 75s are at right now.
Oh, man.
But yeah. They were $50 earlier in the summer and trading at that. And I, so you don't win all of them.
No, it's going to be playing enough.
But I think Tesla's very much in play, and there's a possibility of putting yourself in the way of some good news. What else is going on with Tesla?
Well, the second item I had was that earlier in the week they had announced a CHAdeMO adapter for the Tesla plug. So Tesla to CHAdeMO.
You may pat me on the back briefly.
There we go. I knew that was coming.
Guys, I gave you guys. The early a warning on this. This is going to be a battle on this fast charge thing. Unlike the J1772 public charging infrastructure, a la ChargePoint,
yes,
which doesn't matter, never did matter, the fast charging standard does matter and will matter.
Does matter, yes.
And it's it is a huge stakes game to the point that even Tesla has now blinked. They really own it this week. They opened their 25th supercharger station in Columbia, Texas, 74 miles west of Houston.
Okay.
That's their 25th supercharged station. They actually are building it out. Are they building it out at a magic wand pace? No, but you know, you really got to do a lot of things to build one of these things. You got to get permits get land and do site survey and... For all I know, make sure you're not mashing the lives of any poor snail daughters.
Yeah, there's a frog or
probably
a bird
an
out
EPA
there.
Report that has to be reported. Yes. You know, it's one thing to say I got a lot of money. I'm gonna build a charge station over there. Make it so, and to actually getting something in the ground with electrical connections and city approvals and federal approvals and state approvals.
And who knows what else? Yeah,
and it's kind of hard to do. But in less than a year, they've gone from 0 to 25.
Mm-hmm. That's
at the same time, they have had a crisis of confidence that's really the thing to do in the face of, we reported or repeated 306 CHAdeMO stations in the country. Nissan has since come out with another press release. Now, these people lie so badly that they should be Democrats and they should be in Washington.
Well, the government shut down.
Well, Nissan isn't.
Oh, that's right.
and they announced that they've already installed 800 CHAdeMO fast charge stations at their dealerships, which they have not.
How many dealers do they have, you think?
1,600 or so.
So that means half of them would have, in states where they don't even sell the Leaf.
And then there's no possibility of any part of that being true.
Yeah.
They have repeatedly announced 100% coverage of fast charge stations at Nissan dealerships. They couldn't get a dealer to put in a candy machine and a coffee bar if they paid for it themselves. They have apparently no control of these dealers at all and have thrown in the towel on that one and announced a new program. This gets even better.
But wait, there's more.
You can install a CHAdeMO supercharge station and Nissan might give you $15,000.
Behind the curtain?
Well, it's kind of hard to tell. You'll get a 30% federal tax credit for that. And if you get it done by December 31st, Nissan may send you $15,000. And how will you know? Well, it's kind of unclear.
Oh.
You need to contact Nissan, and they'll evaluate it and look at your entity and your location and determine if that's a place where they might want one.
They'll take it under advisement?
Yes.
Okay.
We'll take it under consider advisement.
Yes.
And they may send you $15,000 or not. And what kind of program is that?
Well, it's not a Google. Didn't Nissan already have a price for a CHAdeMO charging station at one point?
Nissan announced 2 years ago that anyone, even moi, could purchase a CHAdeMO charge station from Nissan through a partnership for $10,000.
Well, it sounds like it's a little more expensive now.
Well, now they're saying it's about $40,000 to put in one.
Okay.
And they don't remember anything about that $10,000 thing. But
memory.
they might, absolutely might send you $15,000 if you'll spend $40,000 putting one in somewhere, depending on where.
Where and if they like you. Oh, what a deal. Such a deal.
It's stunning. They think that this ploy will overnight allow them to double, triple, quadruple, or even not affect at all the number of CHAdeMO stations in the United States.
And Ben, that's right. What was A and B? I'll take C.
And
nothing.
This is hilarious.
It is.
But meanwhile, Tesla is throwing in the towel. They're going to continue with their supercharge stations, but they are going to sell an adapter for $1,000, which is a fairly reasonable price,
starting
the beginning of the year. Anybody with a Tesla Model S that wants to take advantage of CHAdeMO charge stations as well can buy this adapter.
Buy the adapter, yeah.
And so it's not entirely an uncunning ploy. You see, with the Model S, you can charge at the good supercharge station. Mm-hmm. Or you can go slumming out one night on the south end of town,
find yourself
charging
in a
with
bar.
The riffraff. Depending on your needs, it's available to you. Now, that door doesn't swing the other way, see. Nissan doesn't do an adapter so you can plug into a Tesla supercharger.
No, not the other way. No.
It's kind of a one-way deal. So it does work out for Tesla. Meanwhile, GM, what's their ploy?
Oh, no. What?
They're going to study it more, and they're going to study Tesla, and they're going to introduce the Cadillac ELR, and the spark's been delayed till the end of the next
till
year.
Something happens.
But anyway, CCS, the J1772 SAE standard, Rev-B, now forever known as CCS.
CCS.
The combined charging system.
Yes.
Continues to plod on into a total irrelevancy with no cars
right.
and one charge station
right.
announced but not deployed at the Fashion Valley Mall in San Diego.
That's right, yes.
And so this is turning into a raging battle of comic proportions.
You gotta love it.
Man, I like them when they're of epic proportions. This one's shaping up to be in comic proportions.
That's right.
With Nissan issuing the dumbest press release I've ever read by an automaker who mostly own the genre of dumb press releases. I mean, nobody can do it like an automaker.
Automakers own it.
But Nissan's reached a new height. They might give you $15,000 if you put up a CHAdeMO charging station.
A $10,000 charging station?
Jeez. You gotta love it.
Man, I'm exhausted. Are we near the end of the show? I'm getting exhausted from all that. That's a whole lot of thinking.
I'm getting roaring. This is going to be a big deal, guys.
Yes.
It removes the final objection to the electric car and lays bare the reality that you don't need all that batteries. We're doing less batteries in our cars, not more.
Yeah.
We're shooting for less range around here, not greater. It's because we found over time we just don't need it to rat around town doing our daily lives. It's not 90% of the time. It's all the time.
Yeah, it's
you just don't need it. Now, if you want to go touring across the country, my story is get a DC3. They fly low and slow. It's very romantic. The roar of the engines, the smell of the gasoline, it brings back an era gone by.
That's right, some nostalgia.
But oddly, they're even more expensive than an electric car.
Yes, that's right.
And so,
yes,
what they want to do is get in a car and drive cross country. If that's what you like to do, for whatever smarmy reason you've come up with, I think you ought to be able to do it. And as it so happens, I know a little secret. The car doesn't care.
No.
And the batteries will quite happily charge in about the same time that it takes to fill up a gasoline tank. That's none of the problems. The problem is, it's tough to get 150 to 200 kilowatts of power in your hand and squirt it into a car without welding eight or nine vehicles together in one massive arc. It's a lot of power very quickly.
A lot of power.
30, 40 kilowatts in 20 minutes is a lot of power.
It is. That's a lot of power.
And it's a non-trivial engineering function. The deployment function actually is remarkably trivial by comparison.
Yeah, looking at building it, all the permitting and everything.
We
yeah.
took a look yeah. at 47,000 miles of interstate highway system in the United States. All countries in Europe have a fraction of that, not even close to it. And to do all 47,000 miles with a fast charge station every 50 miles is 1,150 charge stations. Total.
Yeah, that's not a lot. It really isn't a lot to cover the entire United States. No, that's not.
Once you have them there, it's a matter of how many bays do you need to meet the demand.
Sure.
And right now, you need zero.
That's right. You'll need one eventually.
One would be overkill.
One would be over everywhere.
But it would be nice for the odd duck going down the freeway in his Model S to be able to stop there and fast charge.
Yes.
And so that would be cool. But it isn't anything to do. A car will do 100 or 120 miles. And that's a two-hour drive.
Right.
Yeah. And touring becomes feasible, and the last objection goes away.
That's right. Yeah, range is
you don't
is
need
off the table.
Any in a town at all. You need a town so you can get a hamburger while the 20 minutes is going by.
Exactly. Yeah, you need a travel guide so you know where to go eat.
Right. Right. So. Or a pita pocket with vitamin water,
That's
you know.
Right. Depends on what state you're in.
Depends on the state. Here it's a big gulp and a ho ho.
That's right.
Moon pie and an RC cola.
Anything wrapped in foil is good.
Yeah. So it's so I think it is important, and it is going to be perceived important by the buying public. And right now, Tesla is a huge leap out with 25 charge stations. They're free. Mm-hmm. They put them up on a map. It's not like Nissan's rumored to be charge stations. And they're kind of 24/7, and you go charge there. People do that already. GM has nothing in the bag, and Nissan has bizarre public relations team who should all be fired summarily and hire a kindergarten class with Crayolas. They'll do a better job for you. Just randomly drawing stuff to put on the refrigerator across the land.
Paper, crayon.
Go into refrigerator advertising with a group of 800 kindergartners and you would do better than you're doing right now, Nissan. It's pathetic. It's embarrassing. It's embarrassing to read your press releases. They're a horror. Hire a group of kindergartners and a big stock of Crayola.
Sidewalk chalk.
Do your stuff on refrigerator doors across the land. Mom, buy a leaf.
That's right. What do you think of this?
So,
oh geez.
But this battle is front and center. It's a big deal.
It's a big deal, absolutely.
And we're going to follow it. We have to find a wedge to get you into the game. Now, one of the technical surprises here is this does not look like a very big device or a very complicated one. I was told that Tesla had used this PHY green grid protocol, AC, data over AC power, which is a horrifying mess, I think. It's a very complicated protocol. I guess it doesn't matter when it's all in the chips anyway. But there's only one chipset that I can find. And CHAdeMO is CAN bus, which everything in the car is CAN bus now.
Sure. Yeah.
We even do CAN bus.
Yes.
It's but here's this little device that can translate that to CHAdeMO's CAN bus.
Yeah. In a handle.
What's the likelihood that they're really using that green protocol?
Yeah, if they're in there. Yeah, if they may not be at all.
Yeah, I guess I would, if there's one thing I could wish for Christmas, is that Tesla will be a little bit more open about this stuff if they're really doing it for the good of the world. Criminy. Throw us a bone here. Why is everything so closed and proprietary?
Need the info.
Need the info. Open it up a little bit.
I think.
You're wearing your underwear too tight.
Ow. Wedgie.
Wedgies. That's what causes wedgies.
That's really what causes wedgies.
What else you got?
That is about it for the news.
Good, because we're way in, man. 4-hour show.
We're way in.
Let's see,
deep.
I covered Nissan's $15,000 reward program, I think adequately.
Yes, I do.
$800 per week. Tesla's $8,000 per quarter.
Yes.
BMW range extender.
We didn't
$3,875. I think this car is a sleeper.
Yeah. No,
I like this car.
Yeah.
And I haven't seen one myself.
No.
I haven't ridden in one, but I just got a sneaking suspicion I'm going to like a Beamer.
Good press releases out of BMW then.
And then fairly clear stuff.
Yes.
And this range extender, which I think you need like you need another little captain to follow around through life.
Yeah.
But it's $3,875. That's pretty reasonably priced.
That's not bad. No, that's not bad. Yeah, and they were saying that it really doesn't affect the performance and the car and having a little fuel tank up front where you don't have anything anyway but a 12-volt battery, so I think it'd be pretty cool.
Guess who stopped by this week?
Who stopped by?
John Scribner.
Oh, yeah.
Monday.
I met with John, yes.
John was a BBS operator.
He was.
Turned ISP.
Yes.
He sold his ISP business in July.
Yes.
Man, talk about hanging out.
Yeah, I was just going to say, he's one of the late bloomers.
John, everybody else got out in the late 90s. They took a hint when Jack got out of the Boardwatch magazine.
That's right.
Started selling their ISPs. He only hung in there another 15 years.
Yeah.
Man, but in kind of a rural area up in Mount Vernon, and did pretty well for himself. He's sold the company and has a new vocation.
Oh.
He's going to build him pontoon boats with solar roofs on them.
Okay.
And was down Monday to pick up a bunch of components.
He did.
For his first prototype.
Yes.
He's going to build three right off the bat.
Might as well, because there's at least two lakes up there that I know of, and you need one in the showroom.
You know, maybe you can do this for me instead of me doing all the research. Find out for next week.
Okay.
How many lakes in the United States have restrictions on horsepower and wake and all this with the internal combustion thing? Some of them have outlawed them entirely. Mm-hmm. And just what is the status? There is a huge groundswell of lakes with houses on them where they want the internal combustion engine to go away. They don't like those boats on the lake after they built a house on the lake.
Imagine that.
I can't really work all this out, the logic stream, but they're mostly Democrats.
Well, it's just, it's what do you call it? Like condominium association.
Condominium association.
Gone wild.
Run them up.
Yeah, gone wild. Yeah.
Anyway, it plays into this. Sailboats. We just won the America's Cup against the Kiwis. The only one I saw, we were already like nine down. And if we lost that one, we would lose the whole thing. And somehow they came back.
Came roaring back. Yes, yay, U.S.
This is the heartland, guys. America's Cup is red, and it's, we call it a polo cup. And it's full of beer.
That's right.
And our boat is a pontoon boat. Looks like a patio. We've got our straddle lounger on it.
That's right.
We got our barbecue.
Oh, yeah. Don't knock over
the grill. We got a cooler full of beer and sometimes TV with the Cardinals on it. We call it the Redneck Yacht Club.
Go Cards.
And the only difference between us and the rest of the boating community is we have a lot of fun.
That's right.
And they'll, over at Kentucky Lake, Ryan, they'll raft up 40 of these things.
Really?
In this one cove. All the chicks take off their tops. All the guys pop theirs. And they party like hound dogs.
That's right.
All afternoon in the sun. And it's actually a lot of fun. It's like this city starts growing in the middle of the water. And people are just with all kinds of boats. Of course, the stars are the pontoon boats.
Yeah.
Because they got the barbecue
they're
grills,
flat, and they got the beer and the grill,
beer coolers, yeah. You know, the furniture and stuff. But people pull up in anything, tie up and hop out and start joining the party. and they get, sometimes they get 35 or 40 boats rafted up out there.
Oh, man.
It's like a little city has grown and people are walking around through all the
from
boats.
From boat to
boat. You know, in just kind of this raft of beer, women and sun.
Wow. I know that's pretty good raft.
It's a tough work, but somebody's got to do it. That's their point. That's
exactly. All right, I'll go ahead and sacrifice my liver for that.
You betcha. And so John is with the Redneck Yacht Club, and he's decided to become an electric pontoon boat supplier.
Cool.
That's to the Midwest.
Fun. Yeah. That'll be great.
And we're going to support him.
Yes. Maybe even see some videos or something from him.
But I'm hoping to get him hooked up with a video camera.
Get him some videos.
Speaking of which, let's do enough about us.
Oh, all right.
I can see a day pretty quick where we don't have to do EVTV, Brian. Let's go to our European correspondent, EVTV EU, Anna Kloopenberg. Come in. Did-da-da-da-da.
Hey, EVTV, we're here again in Amsterdam. It is a rare, fine day in October, and the Delta project's been running out a little bit for our schedule. We don't quite have our tip tweaked and tuned yet, but it's such a nice day, and I just want to finally have a little bit of fun with this boat. We've been working on her so much. So, time to get her out into the water. Sadly enough, it's always a couple-man job to get her trailered and over to the good pond. So I have a few friends from down the road helping me out today. Especially Nick. Get in here.
Hi, Anna.
Heidi, Nick. How you doing? Now, wait a second. Nick's not from down the road at all. Nick's from New Zealand, which is like best, literally the other side of the world. What are you doing here, Nick? How'd you end up here?
I'm up here for a trade show in Hamburg next week. We're exhibiting our new product for my other day job. And we hope to sell some stuff. Don't come all the way to Amsterdam and not see Anna.
Absolutely, absolutely. Well, we're starting to turn into a bit of an EV EVCon orphanage here in Europe. You know, people getting their fix in between the EVCon sessions over in Cape Girardeau. Have to come to Amsterdam for a little bit of EV fun. So Nick's going to come out with us today, and Ray, and we'll put the boat in the water and grab a couple of beers and have some fun. What do you think?
I think that's a great idea.
Okay, let's go do it. Well, there's Ray and Nick heading off to the sluices. I'm going to go pick up our support boat. You guys enjoy yourselves. I'll be back in a little bit. We're here with Nick Smith of New Zealand, although we're all the way over in Amsterdam. He just had to come by and see us.
We're out on the water, playing with some high voltage,
yeah.
Drinking a little beer, going for a boat ride.
Cheers to Jack and Brian, right?
Jack and Brian.
That's a perfect one. You guys want to hold on to your beers kind of and speed away from me?
Yeah. See you later.
See you later, alligator. Man, there she goes. Say, first order of business probably get Ray here in the boat with me and have Nick drive the Delta. We have today's test pilot for our completely uninsured prototype, very dangerous one Kiwi race boat. We have stuntman Mr. Smith.
Trying to keep the weight down. Unfortunately, I'm driving it.
Hey, so the two things I'd like you to find is one, when you're planing, and kind of keep a hold on the GPS speed and kind of get a feel for at what speed she's coming up.
Yep.
Then go on to a speed that you still feel comfortable doing, whatever it is, and you know, top it out a bit. And then bring her back to the lowest speed that you can get her still planing.
Right.
Yeah, and then check what the amperage that is. Yeah.
And the speed.
Yeah, that'd be really cool. And we'll do it a couple times until it works, or you killed yourself, or any either of those. Yeah, let's do pylon and back and that kind of thing, and we'll go at you know, some speed and follow you. So we'll have some good footage. Okay, man, we're ready if you are. Do your thing. It's out and over. Okay. Let's get some EV grin there.
We're looking at 59 kilometers an hour at 550 amps topping out.
Okay.
And then come back to the plane, drop down to about 40, 42, and 190 amps.
Okay. So 40, 42 is a good planing speed.
Yep.
At 190 amps?
90, yep.
190 amps times 150. So 150 volts. What would 190, 150? Anybody's good at quick math here? So we're 1900 kilowatt hours and add half, so like 27 kilowatt from the battery, continuous, would be 42, you said?
42.
That's pretty good, because that I can do for 45 minutes.
It's bouncing up and down a bit. The GPS is a little...
Right, if it's nicely set. Okay.
Guys, get out the way and have another go.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. Doesn't count till you do it three times. When you passed us just after, you were wild man.
42 kilometers at 170, but still on the plane about 30-34, and it was down more like 125.
Right.
So,
even a little better.
Nice. Yeah.
And your max, what did your speeds?
59 again.
Hi, this is Nick Smith reporting from eMotion EV about the new electric
Delta.
We're testing it out on the harbour here in sunny Amsterdam in a nice October day. And first impressions, very good. She's smooth, she's fast, and she's just a beautiful piece of machinery. Only thing I would say, it could do with a cup holder.
Yeah.
I got nowhere to put my beer.
But we gave you a beer.
Yeah. And it's a little tough to drive when you're gripping a beer between your knees. But overall, I think we'll give it a 9 out of 10.
Oh, that's great, man. That's great. I have not had the Delta out for a day of fun yet. For, you know, all the years long project that we've had her, it's been a lot of planning and life gets in the way of stuff you're doing. In actual build time, I would say restoration, probably a good month, and conversion, actual build time is probably 2 weeks. It took us a better part of a year to get it all together. But by now we do have a nice range of EVTV components to choose from, which really helped us get it all together in the end. Anyways, we'll have a little more fun in the sun and a few more beers and take it while the weather's good. So the tablet is tethered to the phone and has internet, so I can stream Spotify music. The tablet itself is connected via Bluetooth to two Bluetooth speakers, and if everything works the way I think it does, I should press the song. I'm even feeling a tiny bit of bass through my ass here.
Better guys.
Yeah. Yeah, you know, I mean, speeding around and everything's cool, but electric, it shines cruising, doesn't it?
You gotta be seen, man.
Yeah. 2 miles an hour so everyone can see you. But it's like, oh, well, how long is the charge and how fast can you go? How far is it? 4 amps cruising. We've got 128 on that, so, yeah, that's longer than the day, so 4 hours than the day is long.
Which movie does it? The song about summertime. It's a little Smith, isn't it?
Yeah, it's a little Smith. Shall we put it on? Let's put it on.
Summertime?
Yeah, we got internet here. Let's see if we can do that right away. Search. Summertime. DJ Jazzy Jeff and the Fresh Prince.
Yeah, that's it. Please.
You ordered? Oh, yeah.
Fish and jump in, and the cop is hot. Yeah, mom, all right.
Out of our 135, so that's pretty much the play range, and always enough to get back home. New electric Delta, she's not disappointing, I gotta say. There's room for improvement. There's some tweaks and bobs, and
cup holder.
We need some props, we need a cup holder, we need to address some vibration issues, but I think we've got a pretty cool toy here. Good Eevee grins. Haven't had some fun out in the sun for a while now. So, good day. Good day for new electric.
Oh, it's pretty cool. I like that. And did I recognize someone in that video? Who was that?
What's going on? We're getting like this international Evcon club.
I know.
Here, Nick Smith happens to be in Europe. On business,
yeah. Yes.
Stops in to see Anna.
Oh, yes. Nick and Anna show. And
I know, he's the model, the body double, in the red Delta Flyer.
She had a beer bottle or some bottle in his lap there for a moment.
He was already suggesting design changes, specifically around the beer bottle.
I did hear about a cup holder or something.
Yes, cup holder appears to be a pregnant idea in the Delta Flyer.
Yeah.
See, we don't have that problem with the pontoon boats.
No, but, that's right. You just put them on the
shelf. Those speedboat guys got to, you know, they got to think this thing through. But that's pretty good sailing there, Anna.
Yeah, it's a
and
nice boat.
And I think he's going to do very good. Again, what's the attractive features of doing the electric boat, so the electric car, certainly in Europe? One, less regulation.
Yes.
Less inspections. That holds true here. Now, yeah. The funny thing is, I never heard anybody sinking and drowning in a car.
No.
but they have much more inspections on automobiles and boats. We were on the Mississippi River and pulled up to a guy with like five guys, five gals, on a raft made out of plastic drums with a bicycle pedaling a rear stern wheeler and a lemonade stand umbrella.
Really?
Oh, and no. A table and they're all roaring drunk going down the Mississippi River at 0 miles an hour, right in the middle of the channel, and barges are running aground around them because they don't want to run over
them. Trying not to hit them.
And they had started like in Kansas City or something on the Missouri River or some rivers and had gone down through St. Louis and into, and they were going all the way to New Orleans.
Oh, man.
I hear they finally, the barge guys made such a ruckus about it that down in Mississippi, they pulled them off the boat, arrested them, took them into town, 22 miles from the river, and told them they couldn't find anything to charge them with, and they were free to go.
They let them go.
But they wouldn't give them a ride back to the river.
Oh, hitchhike back to the...
And when they did get back, their raft was
gone. Thing, their thing had floated into the Gulf of
And that's Mexico. How they got them off the yes. river. And so there's not really any inspection of any of this stuff.
Jeez.
And the second thing, of course, is that boats are a somewhat amorphous value proposition. We know to the uttermost farthing what a car is worth based on the amount of tread left on the tires.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But boats start at about $250 for your average inflatable raft and top out at about $3.5 billion on an aircraft carrier, depending on aircraft.
Yeah, that's depending on the weapon system you deploy.
Is that right? With the two squadrons or without?
That's right.
And
the optional and squadrons.
So, and they have something in between for everybody.
Sure.
And of all the boat owners in the world, about 0.0001% of them need a boat at all.
Right.
These are really commercial good. Fishermen, sure. underwater salvage guys, dredgers, and people that have to work with
right.
boats.
Right, exactly. Yep.
None of the rest of them need one at all. They just want one.
They want a boat, that's right.
And so they have them.
So it doesn't matter at all. The value.
It's a fascinating process to watch. Again, the well-intended Democrats passed a luxury tax here in the United States.
Oh, yeah.
And applied it specifically to yachts. Would you believe I never saw a wealthy guy who wanted a yacht without one and all of that?
That's right.
It was like a 75% tax on luxury yachts. They never collected a single dollar of the tax.
Really?
Never had a collection under this tax on a boat.
Really?
Not one. And completely decimated an entire industry in Maine and Massachusetts.
Yeah, up on the eastern
companies
coast,
that had been in the same family for 200 years were put completely out of business.
Yeah.
All the employees who were working heroically at $11 an hour were put out of work in those family businesses and completely destroyed it. Pretty much conceding yacht building to Europe.
Yeah,
and anywhere else where they didn't have this goofy penalty tax that was supposed to penalize the rich guys, none of whom ever missed a night on a yacht.
That's right. Yeah,
they just quit buying them in America.
Yeah, that's right. Other places.
And completely killed that industry. Now that you got, it's incredible. The heroic scale of stupidity that we have going on in our government with that sort of thing. They couldn't predict any of that.
Imagine that.
And the OMB even had millions of dollars in the budget for money they were going to collect with, and they never collected a dime. There was never a payment made, not a boat sold with a 75% tax on.
Yeah, imagine that.
Luxury tax, you imagine? And so rave on about boats. I think they're cool. And because of the lesser regulations and the wider range of valuations, coupled with kind of, it all goes with the green environment scheme, but also with some very real things about smells, oil puddles
oil
on
slicks,
the water,
yeah.
and noise.
Yes.
and we can make it go away, at least locally in lakes and harbors and so forth.
Absolutely.
I'm not sure I'd want to sail the world on one charge, but...
Maybe we can get Tesla to put a supercharger out in the Pacific or something.
If you could, then yeah. maybe so. Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I am having a ball with the thing.
Oh, yes. Yes.
And we have received 100 Siemens Motors.
Yes, we have.
I'm going to show them a little clip of the dungeon back there full of motors. They're all factory fresh and beautiful, clean, new boxes.
They are.
And we've got a lot of them. We're doing some neat things with the GEVCU.
Yes, yes.
And...
Oh, they're everywhere.
Paulo motors.
They're everywhere, I tell you.
Nice, clean boxes,
yeah,
too.
They're nice.
They're looking good. I did score another 9 DMOCs.
I saw they came in this week, yes.
And so we're gathering. I've got 95 encoder cables coming.
Oh, good. Okay.
And from a guy that had a bunch in a box. So it's coming together. The big end of that is the GEVCU, of
yes,
course.
Yes, yes.
And we're driving the thing and have, as I noted last week, the Wi-Fi
yeah.
up and working where we can configure it.
Yeah, it's pretty cool.
We have now a third version of the hardware coming from Lisbon, Portugal.
Yay!
And our... this is part of the electric vehicle Ass Clown International team. Celso Menia and Paulo Almeida of the Institute of Engineering in Lisbon.
In Lisbon, Lisboa.
Shout out. Come in, Paulo and Celso.
Hello, I'm Celso Menia, and I'm here with
Paulo Almeida.
And this is EVTV, Portugal?
Portugal, maybe, yeah.
Who knows? Yeah. So, we start here with a sweet wine from the Setúbal. It's a Muscatel de Setúbal. And let's just start to open this, and Paulo will do the honors of talking a little bit more.
Tasting. We are not, we actually would need here Brian to talk a little bit about wines because he's the expert, but it's a wine that I like very much and we decided to use this here today, so let's see how this goes. Meanwhile, we have prepared some video for you guys about what we have been done with the GEVCU and the DMOC and a little bit about what we do here. in Lisbon. So. Oh, it's good. Hey, so let's enjoy our wine and take a look at the video.
Yeah.
Yes.
Nice.
So, here we are in the main entrance of ISEL. ISEL stands for Instituto Superior de Engenharia de Lisboa, or in English, Higher Institute of Engineering Lisbon. ISEL was founded in 1852, so it's over 160 years old, making it the oldest engineering school in Portugal. It was here that I graduated in 2007 and I worked since 2008 as a lab technician and researcher in the area of electrical machines. So, next let's go take a look at our electrical machines lab. I believe we have a delivery coming, so let's go.
Espera aí.
this is our electrical machines lab here. We have the DMOC all set up with the Siemens motor. And now I'm going to show you a little bit of our lab. This is the lab where our electrical engineer students come and learn about electrical machines. In the first classes, we teach them simple prototypes, like for example this Thomson ring here that you can see on this workbench. And simple rotating machines like a simple three-phase asynchronous motor. After this first experiments, they will start to connect the real industrial machines. For that, we have 10 workbenches that we designed ourselves and built, and several machines behind them that they use in class.
Quero destino que eu não creia no destino. E o meu fado é nem ter fado nenhum. Cantá-lo bem, sem sequer o ter sentido. Senti-lo como ninguém, mas não ter sentido algum. Ai que tristeza esta minha alegria. Ai que alegria esta tão grande tristeza. Esperar que um dia eu não espere mais um dia. Por aquele que nunca vem e que aqui esteve presente. Ai que saudade que eu tenho de ter saudade. Saudades de ter alguém que aqui está e não existe. Sentir-me triste só por me sentir tão bem. Alegre sentir-me bem só por eu andar tão triste. Ai se eu pudesse não cantar, ai se eu pudesse. E lamentasse não ter mais nenhum lamento. Talvez ouvisse no silêncio que fizesse uma voz que fosse minha cantar alguém cá dentro. Ai que desgraça esta sorte que me assiste. Ai mas que sorte eu viver tão desgraçada. Na incerteza que nada mais certo existe. Além da grande certeza de não estar certa de nada. Ai que saudade que eu tenho de ter saudade. Saudades de ter alguém que aqui está e não existe. Sentir-me triste só por me sentir tão bem.
For the DC machines that we have here in the lab, we need DC power. Since we don't have a battery bank, we have this dynamic conversion group here. It's composed by a synchronous machine here in the middle and two DC dynamo generators or dynamos. They are connected in series, so we can get up to 250 volts at 150 amps total. So let me show you now how our classes sound. Volts at 60 Hertz. We also have an alternator here, coupled to a DC machine, so we can actually produce power with different voltages and different frequencies than the ones that we have here in the room. So this is our setup here for power generation in our lab.
Here is a room next to the lab where we do our work and research. And in our free time, that's not a lot, but we dedicate ourselves to to a brand name that we registered as Converter. And that was after we worked in the Vico project for 3 years. We remember to start this company, a startup, for developing solutions in the electric mobility. One of the first things that we did was this prototype. This is our first prototype for an EVC, for charging electric cars. And we use the standard plug here in the Europe, that is the Menia's type plug. And this was our very first prototype. And then we also did build a charging station. This is to put outside for people who charge their electric cars. We also use the Menia's type plug here. And you can see in the back the wiring. This was also our first attempt to do our big AVC, and that was the result.
Okay, one of the other projects that we have done with Converter is to actually convert a smart car to electric drive with lithium iron phosphate cells. In this case, the Cal 40 amp cells from the new CA series. Here we can see our battery guy at the moment looking very worried about the batteries, because we actually forgot the DC to DC converter on, and our 100 volt pack is at the moment at 40 volts. So
more like 24 volts. So S clowns take 3 on battery. Guys doing screw-ups. So our battery, our 34 cells, are with a total of work with 24 volts. We are just with a small power supply, just putting them on a slow charge, so to them to get up, and when they get up to voltage, we then will connect the charger and let them charge.
So
no problem. Actually, this has happened once already. So this is the second time we make this pack flat. It should be no worries.
Button balance works every time.
Yeah. When we were at the FCON, Jack asked us what was the soldering iron that we used for our SMD stuff. And it's here. It's a matte cowl. This is the MX500 soldering station, and it comes with iron. The tips are exchangeable, so we can exchange the tips on the soldering iron to solder what we need. And this is an induction soldering iron, so it's very effective. And that's it, Metcal MX500. It's our choice for soldering iron.
Okay, some of you guys have questions about how to solder the ARM Cortex microcontroller. So I'm going to show you how I do it. You take it, you line it up on the board by hand, as good as you can. Okay, good alignment. Take the soldering iron and apply a little heat to the corners, like this. Now it's in place. Next, you apply some SMD flux and just go gently with the soldering iron over the pins. the solder on the PCB is enough to solder the chip in place. If you get any solder bridges, just apply a little bit more flux and clean it with the iron, but I think we are good to go. Just here in this corner a little bit maybe. Okay. Next step. We have lots of flux, so you have to clean it. For that we use a printed circuit board cleaner. Just apply it. Next, just paper, dry it off. One other tool that I find very useful when doing this is a USB microscope. This one I got on eBay for around 20 euros, and it's great to look at your soldering job. To see if everything is okay. Okay, looks good. Here we have a small soldering bridge, we have to rectify this. Very good. Okay, only one solder bridge. So, to solve this, just put a little bit more flux on that area, clean the soldering tip, and just reheat the whole seam. Done. I would say this is almost perfect. Okay. Clean it again. Let's check our work. Okay, that's good. Nice and clean. Soldering bridge is gone. Okay, perfect. This is done. Now only the big components missing. Okay, I just finished assembling the microcontroller block and the USB block of the diagram. I cleaned the circuit after soldering all these components, and we are now able to test this part of our GEVCU-3. So, for that we're going to plug in the USB cable, and the first thing we should see is the 3.3 volt LED turning on, meaning that we are successfully converting the 5 volts from the USB to 3.3 to power the ARM Cortex. Next thing we should see is a serial port on the computer side. For that I'm going to open here the Arduino IDE. Okay. And okay, so we have a new port com, in this case 67. We have to love Windows. Every time we plug it in we have a new com port. And I'm now going to try to upload a program. For that I'm going to choose the basic Blink that we all love. So, on the Blink example, it's usually pin number 13, and I have put also a LED on pin number 13, so just uploading. compiling, and now it's uploading, and just wait a little bit more, and success. We have a blinking light. This means that this part of the circuit is working correctly, and we can now assemble the rest of our GEVCU-3. So, let's do that for now. This is the final assembly of the GEVCU-3 board, with all the components that were missing and ready to test. Before testing this, let's talk a little bit about the enclosure for the GEVCU-3. The enclosure I selected is the TÜV series from Fisher Electrics. It's not the perfect enclosure for this application because it's not waterproof, but it's black anodized, and that's a very cool thing to have because you can easily engrave it with a laser engraver. So let's take a look at that.
Okay, so for the markings and the letters on our aluminium boxes, we use the laser machine. It can engrave in aluminium, so, and that's what we did. We just put our drawings on the computer and printed them with this laser machine on the aluminium boxes, and you can see here the how this has been done. Of course, this is accelerated time because this takes a little bit of time, and this is showing how we did the engravings on the aluminium boxes on the front side and on the back side with all of the pinouts of the hemp seal. I think that's very useful, so you don't need to have a paper with a pinout or seeing on the computer the pinout. You just have here the pins and what they do, and that's handy. So in the computer, and the work finished and done. For cutting the holes on the aluminium plates, we use a small CNC machine to cut the holes for the hemp seal and the USB port.
And this is the end result, with the enclosure and our GEVCU board already inside. Next step is going to test it and try to spin our DMOC with our GEVCU-3. So let's see what happens.
So our Siemens just arrived, and you assembled it here in the lab with the DMOC. Paulo is there running CC shell. So what's our setup here? We have the GEVCU, the third version, power supply for the 12 volts. And then here we have a small rectifier to get energy to the DMOC. Right now we have the rectifier disconnected from the grid, so we don't have high voltage yet, just 12 volts, and we're going to do some trials to see if everything is okay, and then hook up the high voltage and see if the motor spins.
So our first spin of the Siemens.
So, that was it. I hope you enjoyed our program this week.
Yeah.
Hopefully we will have some time next week or so to do something else, but keep up and back to you, Jack.
Yeah.
Oh my, I like that music selection.
Oh yeah,
a little guitar.
Now have a little music here.
Hopefully we don't have to pay any royalties for that.
Yeah. You know, usually it gets me thrown off YouTube. Actually, they don't throw me off anymore. They punish the people with iPhones.
Oh,
if you can't download from YouTube on your iPhone, it's because of some music that somebody included when they sent it in.
Some ASCAP issues.
And they, yeah. So that's their current solution.
That's just no iPhones.
And so
great.
That's as good a bit of video as we've ever received.
That was really good.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
A whole study guide on SMD soldering.
That was pretty amazing.
How about some ideas on how to make enough power for a fast charge?
I did.
How about use an AC motor to turn a DC generator?
A dynamo. Listen to the hum of those dynamos. That would work.
And make DC voltage.
Yes.
Enough to power a fast charge station.
Yeah.
From single phase AC.
Yeah, that was pretty interesting.
You wouldn't need three phase, would you?
No. That's really interesting.
Well, there you go. So there's so much going on there. This is the board that Paulo made. This one's unpopulated except for the SAM microprocessor.
Yes.
Multi-controller. And what he's done basically was taken the Arduino Dewey and all the stuff we were doing to buffer our analog inputs,
right,
and isolate them, and also our digital outputs we had tied into MOSFETs. And this is a pretty neat thing. Instead of the little 50 milliamps you can do on a digital output of an Arduino, it actually turns on a MOSFET that'll do, it'll peak at 7 amps. It'll do 1.7 amps continuously.
Oh, okay.
And it ties it to ground.
Oh, all right.
So you have 12 volts in your car, and you run it through a contactor, say, and hook it up to this digital output, and when it comes on, all it does is turn on a MOSFET, allowing current flow through to ground, the vehicle ground.
Oh, okay.
On the ground side of your thing. So that's called an active low, or a low side switch.
Okay.
And so that's how we do the digital outputs. It has the amp seal, 35-pin, and a place to plug in the Wi-Fi module. Here was the part that I couldn't get over, to the point that I ordered the next day a laser engraver from China.
Yeah, where else could we get one?
Here's their USB. See, they cut it out. I use a port that you kind of screw in and a cable inside that connects it. This is much more compact, of course, but you have to have a very precise cutout.
Yeah.
This is for the antenna, which I don't have yet on it, for the Wi-Fi module, and this is our USB port. But the Arduino has two little micro B ports on it, and they break off very easily.
Yes, yes.
And so they're very delicate, and so I asked for a printer port, what's called the USB 2.0B. It's the little square one, and I think the most robust, physically the strongest.
Right.
And then on this side, of course, is our amp seal 35-pin connector. Next generation, I'm asking for four more digital outputs. We only have four right now.
Okay.
And I can see we use one for a pre-charge relay. We use one for our contactor now.
Okay.
I'm going to use one for the cooling fans, and that leaves me one.
Yeah, that's not enough.
I'd rather have like five left.
Yeah, good. We may think of something.
Well, yeah, there's a lot of things we could think of. Disabling the charger or disabling something else. You just need a lot of gazinas and gazatas. This we're calling GEVCU-3, and since I want these other four ports that he's going to do for me, we can get the boards made in China relatively inexpensively. The laser scribing, I'm going to have a laser engraver anyway, but on the back side, he's got EVTV and a pinout for the GEVCU.
So cool.
Do you ever have a piece of equipment 6 years later and you don't have the diagram with it or the book?
Spilled coffee on the paper?
Well, you're not totally proprietary. It's okay to do this so some future ass clown does not spend 2 months trying to figure out
where all the pins go.
to use this thing.
That's right.
Printed right on here. I love
that. That was pretty cool.
Laser nice thing. Song. I got a 80 watt monster from China.
We
coming.
Can make Christmas presents for people and stuff with it.
Yep, right.
It'll be cool.
So we've shrunk in size. We've gotten hardier. We're not quite as waterproof, but it's a great little package and much less prone to failure.
Yes.
So I think this is much hardier. Much smaller and much better. And it's going to get better yet. And that's the problem.
I know.
We need them now. I've got people out there with these that are waiting on them, waiting on the availability of GEVCU. The software guys, some days they'll do 10 commits of changes to the software.
Oh, man.
And this is GEVCU-3. GEVCU-4 will have 4 more outputs at least.
Right.
And I don't know what other changes. And so we can't get stable on either our hardware design or our software design.
To be able to produce them so we can get some out.
And all of the things that are happening is stuff you would want. It's getting better quickly.
Yes, right.
We've got a very talented, electric vehicle Ass Clowns International. This has been an experience for me. I have been around a little bit of open source stuff with Linux kids that were a mess. This is like mostly adults. Nobody fusses at each other very much. They all get along. They're very professional. Some great coders. And this is, he whipped this out in like a week.
I know, it didn't take long.
And it was another week or 10 days for this went to China as Eagle files and came back as boards. And Paulo soldered the multi-controllers because Ed didn't think he could do it. Although in the video you just saw it, so you need a USB microscope to see if you screwed it up.
But
I'm going to get one of those on order. And but it is some assembly. We have not yet found somebody to put all this together and assemble them. And the problem is I need 30, and then I need 100.
Right.
And they do not have to be free. We'll pay what we need to get them assembled and built. And we'll mark them up. That's what you'll pay.
That's right, exactly.
That'll
be easy.
I can't I make free as in speech. I can't make free as in beer.
That's right.
It just doesn't work. But we're going to have a great little box. I think this thing is going to be so useful. I've already got a guy that wants to get a Reinhardt controller and start on that object module.
Yes, I saw that. Yeah.
Before it's over, you'll see guys running beer breweries from the EVTV GEVCU, and they will never know that it was intended for electric vehicles.
For a vehicle, that's right.
It's just a little multi-controller box with a bunch of inputs and outputs, wireless configuration, and they'll do the software and be running a beer brewery off of it automatically.
Dry cleaner.
And when you say, it's a GEVCU, I didn't know you were into EVs, it'll be, what's an EV?
What's an EV? I wonder why it's an electric
vehicle.
We do vehicle.
IPA here, buddy.
That's right. More hops.
India Pale Ale. Hop it.
More hops.
And that's where I think this is going to go. It's going to be so useful. And because it's kind of open and available. No, we're not going to. The hardware is, you're going to have to buy it. You can make your own. And the software will be freely available. And it'll be readily apparent what you need for inputs and outputs. Mm-hmm. It's all Arduino based. But you can do your own hardware. The problem is hardening it for use in a car.
In a vehicle, exactly, yeah.
And that's sort of non-trivial. But Paulo's just done a remarkable job at stuff I can't even see, and now I know why. He can't see them either.
That's right.
He gets a USB microscope, puts it under there, and then he can see.
That's right.
I just got it. Makes
it a little larger. And
so, but I do not see me sitting around soldering these together. We've got to find some assembly for it. But I'm very excited about it. We're there. We drive the car now. This works. Getting these, to have a pile of 30 of them here, with a stable enough set of software and hardware that I can give it to you, I'm not there yet.
Yeah, that's what we're working towards.
These development projects always go faster than you think or want, don't they?
Yes. They're just speedy. It happens overnight.
Yeah, it's just almost they make themselves.
That's right.
No, this one has. I just did a spec. I mostly fuss and stuff. I haven't written any of the code. I've done any of the hardware. I funded some of it, but the and I thought I'd have to do this myself. Not so. The crowd.
Yeah, right.
John Hardy's wisdom of crowds turns out to be pretty powerful.
Yes, yes.
We've got an international team of ass clowns. They're all pretty friendly and kind of showing up at each other's places globally.
I know.
It's amazing. Kelso shows up at Anna's place, and Ed Clawson's been down here, and
Nick shows up at Anna's.
Nick shows up at Anna's. And
people show up at EFCON. Mm-hmm. You guys need to remember to sign up. It's pretty cool at EFCON, too.
I think it's going, what all that points to is probably a pretty powerful EFCON for 2014.
Yeah.
I don't think you'll want to miss it. I'm going to push Richard Van Wyhe,
okay,
an EV for you, to next week.
All right.
Great build on the Vanagon. We actually carried a thing when he started it. He does a walk around at the end. He's taken careful notes from his EVTV thing and done a fabulous build.
Cool. I can't wait to see it.
I can't wait to show it to you. But I think we better.
Yes.
On account of, oh, I almost forgot. We're not even done yet by a lot, are we? They actually like your rust.
Oh, they like my rust.
Yes,
oh,
let's
man.
Take a look at the karmann Ghia,
okay,
and the progress therein.
So I've been looking for Jamie for the last couple of days. He one time came by and said, I'm going to lunch, and I wasn't sure where he was or where he came back, so I decided to follow him. And look what we found. What are you doing?
I'm surrounded by batteries.
You piled yourself in, and you can't get out, it looks like.
Yeah.
So what are you doing?
Bottom balancing. Lining them all up at the bottom.
Bottom balancing. We've heard that before. And what does that do for us?
Basically, it gets them all in-lined and singing the same song at the top end when they're charged up or closer to each other.
So with by bottom balancing them then, we have them all even at the bottom where all the bad things happen to the batteries, at least from discharge.
Yeah.
And we
can save them as well when we over-discharge.
Yes, and we've seen this. We've seen this in Speedster Redux, in the Toyota Tacoma. We've seen that Jason Horak's car, and depending on where this episode lines up, we have going to or have seen it on someone else's car in this issue. So it looks awfully gory. You've got them lined up here like soldiers standing at attention. You have some kind of contraption set up here. How does this all happen, Jamie?
Well, we've got a voltmeter with a relay. Basically, when it gets down to 2.5, it disconnects the resistor from the circuit. When it hits, goes back up, floats back up, as they do bounce back up,
right,
to 2.76, it clicks back on and brings it back down.
Brings it back down.
So we have to do quite a few runs of them, let them settle,
right,
and then do them again.
Because, yeah, you're going to have to dissipate the charge for a little bit to make sure that you're back at the level that you want. So what he's saying is if you did this manually, that when it hits it the first time,
Which we're about to here
at 2.5. We're at 2.5.05.
Good timing.
4, 3, 2, 1. There you go.
And we can...
And we're watching now, yeah, 2.8, 2.9, 6.9, 2.70, 7.1. So you see it's going to keep climbing, and that, so when you get it down, you're not there yet. There's it's still some charge, and you need to let it sit for a while, and it will definitely bounce back up. So what we've done with the with our meters here is probably, I'm assuming that we're using the normally open and normally closed circuits,
yep,
to relays to trip our our resistor in and our resistor out,
yep,
and we just let that kind of bounce a little bit between the two values.
Now I've got two automatic ones, uh-huh, and one manual one.
And the manual one was the one you just showed us.
Yes, yes. Cool.
Yeah. So these can be done with a big resistor. And how many batteries have you done in the last couple of days? I guess you've done it a full day, maybe.
Yeah, a full day and a bit. We'll say. Okay. I have completed one run on four, and I'm now started on another three.
Okay, and these are all, by the way, the batteries are going into the karmann Ghia. We've also ordered the battery box yesterday, which was a big deal. So as soon as these batteries are balanced, then we'll be able to load them up in the box, strap them together. We'll have to put a charger on them, and then we'll be able to bring them up, the pack as a whole.
Yay.
So I expect your visa to expire before this is done, and you'll just be another illegal here in the United States. And it's a good excuse. He's immigration. He's still balancing batteries. We have proof.
Had to be done.
You know, interns. We don't want anyone to leave here without having a fully developed internship experience. And this is one of those experiences. Well, good on you, mate.
No worries.
All right. Well, Jamie, so here we are inside the set, but we thought we'd just give you a new perspective and stand in front of the bench. What the heck?
Why not?
So we told you last week, we've kind of gotten over the repair aspects of the karmann Ghia. I think that we've put it together fairly well.
Yep.
And now it's time to start dealing with some of the componentry and things, and air conditioning seems to be one of the first things that we should plot out, because we had all of that room where the spare tire normally goes.
Yes.
You know, the shift rod access is through there, and there was actually some repair to the front end of the karmann Ghia, and they had welded up that access to be able to pull that shift rod through the body and out the front end. It kind of confounded chain for a while, but we came to the rescue and told them, "Nah, just cut a hole, it'll come right out." So these are the air conditioning components that Jack and I have had for years from China. We've fired up a couple of the different voltages. I think this was 108 to, I think we'll see it on the...
144 maybe?
To 144. So that should be just fine for us. Hopefully that's not on the low end. If that is, though, this compressor doesn't matter. We'd have to change the controller out, which when you see what Jamie has engineered here, would be relatively easy. So kind of walk us through the steps here, Jamie, if you would, of what you did to get this mounted like this.
Yeah. Well, initially our access hole for the shift rod was about yay big.
Okay.
So we wanted to cover that a little bit past, so we had some good meat for our mounting plates to mount the plate onto the car.
And that'll go right through that, where the access cover was, and through the steel on the front end of the car inside. Okay.
Yes, perfect. Yes. And then obviously we just lined up some tabs, the correct distance for the compressor motor.
And then you just kind of tested it and bolted it up to this template, and that
just
was perfect.
Checked clearances, different things, and made sure everything was going to work.
Okay, nice.
And then we needed a weld, so...
So we basically have this plate now that you've showed us in metal at this point, just a little bit bigger or whatever, but you had had some certain design parameters here. And I guess the piece of steel was this big, and what the heck?
Yes.
No sense making another cut since we didn't need to. Okay.
Yeah.
Nice.
And then we decided the perfect spot would be for our controller.
For the controller, okay.
It'd be just up here.
And then we've got a couple more screws to go here, and Jamie has used real nice, look like stainless steel, Allen key, and then he's got clearance here for the for the plug to actually go in, and that screws down. Whoa. So we don't have any issues. Yeah, we don't have any issues with that. There are a couple of screws to keep that in. So this is all a very nice compact unit, and one of the design criteria was if we needed to replace this, we didn't want to have to take out the compressor. So the compressor, and you'll see that in a few minutes, is sitting real low in the front end of the vehicle. And we'll have access to all of the high pressure and the suction side lines for this as we route our air conditioning system. So I'm excited. Let's go see it bolt into the to the front of the Ghia. This will be a first. All right. So Jamie's here at the front of the car. This may seem a little weird that I'm off the camera, but this is the way it works. We're kind of tight here. So he is going to take the mounted air conditioning unit and bolt it up. He's made a really, really, really nice set of bracketry, as you can see. Actually, he watched a bunch of YouTube videos about welding, I think from whatever the two companies are out there, and any guy he could find with a flamed helmet with a checkered flag that looked like an expert, and got pretty good, at least got the settings right and the heat, and learned how to do some steel. So he had already preset the bolts in there, and is putting them through the body right now. And there you go. That didn't take long, Jamie.
Not too long at all.
Okay, perfect. And then we're going to he'll come up top, and we'll mount the controller. On top, I guess that's really an inverter, I suppose. This is AC. And he already had those two stainless steel Allens that are going to slide right in. And he's just going to tighten those up. And I think we've got a pretty good installation there. And then he's just got the plug and he's left access. And when he engineered this, he's got a little off center, a little more to the passenger side to the right of the car. It gives us good access to the plug, to the hoses, to everything, and I think that we are in good shape for our first component installation in the Ghia. And there he is. There's my hero, Jamie.
Well, I hope you like that. We're starting to put it together. Mm-hmm. I think that we've got the rust mitigated thanks to the crew here, to Shane and to Jamie. But we got the air conditioning compressor in, and we're going to start put the car back together now. So we have one of the design criteria begun with the compressor, the inverter for the air conditioning. And we're going to start putting it together.
We got that compressor and motor 2 or 3 years ago.
We did.
You need to go chase that guy
down. I need
down.
To chase it down.
Get a price and get it on the website.
Put it on
You're
the
about
store.
To build an air conditioner that nobody else can have if we can't find that guy again.
Yeah, that's right.
So take that as an action item.
Yeah.
And a funny story with Shane. He painted the inside shiny black.
He did.
And apparently you instructed him to paint it flat black.
Yes.
And he took umbrage at that. And he got done. He says, I don't know what happened. It looks a lot better. I said, Shane, this is we call this the paradox of the black paint.
Of the black paint.
Spray can caps. He said, what's that? I said, the shiny one looks prettier on the cap.
Yes.
But the flat black one looks better every time when you spray something with it.
Yes, and with that, we probably have to modify.
He said, well, why is that? I said, well, because most of the stuff we spray has lots of dings and dents.
that's right. By the time we
spray
it.
Gouge marks and stuff. But when you paint it flat back, it disappears.
I guess that's the thing. We need to probably update our mantra to paint it flat black. It will disappear.
It will disappear.
Yes.
I'm going to put this up, one of the Evaki Electric Vehicle Ass Clown International guys. Pointed out to me the birthplace of Hewlett-Packard in their garage, and also pointed me to their 11 rules of that they had posted in their garage. And take a look at this. I was so taken with that that I put them together, took the photograph of the garage and the rules and overlaid them and sent them off to a sign company, and you'll be able to have an 18 by 24 inch poster of that from our web store almost immediately. But wait, there's more.
Oh no.
You know, we started in a garage.
We did.
But actually, I did it using the front of this one, because the sign's gone off the
old
one.
Then we got the
trace
up on the
wall.
It's up in here. That's right.
So I took a photograph of that and did our 11 rules.
Oh.
And here you go. The EVTV birthplace, and there are shop rules. Let's all get liquored up, play with some high voltage,
go for a drive.
Paint it black, it'll disappear. Overkill is always appropriate. the whole thing. So we'll have a similar poster on plastic, suitable for framing.
Oh, nice.
On the web store with that. And so, but good job on the Ghia. It's coming along.
It is.
Of course, the battery box is 60% of the job.
And it's at the battery box shop.
Is it coming back?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, it's over at Totes. Mm-hmm. Totes shop. So I think hopefully I'll have it next week. We mentioned that the Jamie had been working diligently at bottom balancing the batteries. It still is.
Another little factoid that come up that I knew and have never mentioned because it slips my mind. He had three cells that would be at like 3.3 volts, and he puts the drain on them.
Okay.
And they immediately go to 2.5 volts. And and then that opens the thing, so it goes back to 3.5 volt, and then back and forth. And he said, "I just don't know what's the matter with this cell."
Was it a bad battery?
I don't know. I've had this happen to me half a dozen times. I've just never mentioned it to anybody. I did take the battery and put it through its paces, 114 amp hours in a 100 amp hour cell, 114 and a half actually. I did, and be on alert on for this. I think they're not fully finishing the batteries now, because when I charged it, it was acting very strangely in the second half of the charge. The voltage would race up at let's say I'm at 70 amps. It races from 3.4 up to 3.75 volts suddenly.
Really?
Huh. And then it races back down to 3.52, and then up again. And it's like wandering. I think there's some diffusion that needs to go on there in the formative stage of the cell that may not be happening with the cell. But it had nothing to do with his problem. I just got off on a thing on this and noticed this. I'll just throw it out. This is happening, and I'm not sure why. We'll learn as we go along. But I think we're seeing some cells that you should probably... if you run into that, the cure is very simple. Simply fully charge the cell.
And then go ahead and balance.
And then go ahead
and
take it to the bottom.
Yeah, okay.
Balance it. And do it a little high. It's okay to be up 3.7, 3.75. That never was going to hurt a cell.
Right.
It's okay. You start getting into some problems with your electrolytes, about 4.35, 4.4 volts. Really, 4.5 is where it goes bad.
Okay. Okay.
And, that's not about overcharging. I'm talking about overvoltaging.
Yes.
But I'm not sure some of these cells are being finished.
Not fully formed.
Yeah, not fully formed. Yeah. The forming process is they very slowly... charge it, and that moves lithium ions out of the cathode where we can put them into the anode where we don't have a way to do that except by charging.
Right.
And they intercalate there, and that's fully charged. Then they set them aside for 2 weeks and let them kind of age like fermenting tobacco or whiskey.
Yeah,
and then they'll cycle them and send them out.
Okay.
And I think some things are being rushed.
Okay.
Because he found three cells like this. Well, the problem he was having with it being at like 3.29 volts, you hook up your bottom balancer and it crashes to 2.5. And it opens the contactor and it races back up to 3.29. Mm-hmm. And so it's going bang, 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 bang. It's a bad connection on your hookup.
Oh,
and some of the bolts now are coming with what look like, what's that stuff we put on the transmission bolts?
Oh, like a, not a cosmoline or something, but a...
a Loctite.
Loctite, yeah. Oh, yes, they're having that blue on the thread locker.
They got thread locker on the bolts now, and they're coming with the bolts in them. So they can put these caps on them for shipping.
Right.
And he didn't have a good connection to the cell. Put a braided strap on each terminal and tighten it up and hook up to that. Oh, when you have a good connection. What it is you're at 3.29 volts, you're not drawing any current. Now you hook it up, you're drawing current, but through a bad connection, and you get a voltage drop through the connection.
And it's bouncing on those.
And so that appears to be 2.5 volts. Well, then you open the contactor. Now you don't have any current flow. It now appears to be 3.29.
Right.
It's just a loose connection. This has got me a couple times in the past. I've got a cell that just acts like it's got nothing. It can't do anything. It can't deliver current. This goes to... nothing as soon as I hook a load up to it. It's because I'm not really hooked up.
Yeah, you're not hooked up.
So check your connections. Let's take a look at our my golf cart modules. I'm continuing to play around with that.
That's right.
Obsessing over something that doesn't really have anything to do with what we're doing. But I'm having a difficult time keeping urethane plastic out of push buttons. And it's driving me crazy. Let's take a look. All righty. When last we spoke, one of the times we spoke, I was talking about a golf cart battery. The whole kind of vision there has expanded a little bit. I've started looking around. There's trolling motors out there, a Torquedo 9-horsepower electric trolling motor, perfect for a pontoon boat.
Nice.
48 volts. Most of the lithium battery offerings for boats and for golf carts are kind of tragic. I don't think they're good at all. Jamie and I have been working on Robert George Frederick. He likes to be called Jamie. We've got him in a lab coat, and I call him Igor. But he had a kind of a neat idea for this. This is our first module we put in the golf cart, kind of industrial strength, 100 pounds, 101 pounds. Let me see if I can tip this over where you can see it a little bit. This is basically an aluminum box. We put the batteries in, strapped them up, zero balanced them very carefully, poured foam around them, and that's an expansive foam, an 8 pound per cubic feet. You mix it like our urethane plastics and put it in, and after about 5 minutes it starts to grow up the side. It's kind of creepy looking, isn't it?
Yes.
You don't know if it's going to stop or not, take over the world. And that kind of locks the batteries in place with a fairly lightweight insulating material. And then we pour our black urethane plastic over the top. We made some terminals that stick up above that, and had that very carefully measured where it just cleared the golf cart seat. Actually, we missed it by that much. It actually digs in a little bit to the bottom of the golf cart seat, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Just makes a little indent there. We can live with it, but it would have been better a quarter inch lower. There are some new little voltmeters out on eBay that will do 0 to 100 volts and measure the voltage of their supply. So you have two wires. We can put one on each end of the pack, and it'll measure it up to 100 volts. Of course, that'll bleed down our battery over time. And so I wanted to put a push button on this where you can push it and read your meter and release it, and it quits draining the battery. So we only drain when we push it, and it's a tiny amount of drain, but 24 by 7, what happens?
It'll die eventually.
It'll add up, won't it?
Yep.
Neat idea. This plastic is like a living thing. We mix this up, it's like a thin liquid, and it gets quite hot as it cures, and it cures in 20 minutes. It'll be pretty much solid to the touch. But it gets in everything. Every time we put a button anywhere near it, we wind up with this plastic in the button, and the button doesn't work. And we've tried everything. This is actually, we've got a little enclosure that sticks down in there. It was supposed to be sealed, and some wires stuck down there, so we could change it. So the battery, I think, will last forever. The meter and the button might not, but you can take off a couple screws and swap out the meter and the button. And that's turned out to be a pretty cunning design, because no matter what we do, we get plastic in the button, and the button doesn't work anymore.
Yep.
And we've tried everything. And we've tried different kinds of buttons. Some of them, just the heat of the plastic will melt the inside of them, and they don't button anymore. Momentary contact. So here's one module. Jamie came up with another idea. Tell them how this started, Jamie.
I just wanted to flip it all upside down just so we get a cleaner finish on the top, basically.
Well, and so we all laughed about that, and then I went puzzling over it, and we decided to try it. Kind of difficult. Our box just isn't quite big enough. What we had to do was put together our battery pack, attach cables to it, feed the cables up through some gland nuts, lower the box over it, and then turn it upside down, and then pour our foam and plastic from the bottom. And as you can see, if I can tilt this up, the bottom is black plastic, just as the top is over here. Now we have our box up here. Well, I found one of the things we had trouble with, I've got these straps, and they're kind of cheesy looking. They're actually quite functional.
Oh, yeah.
They'll last forever. They're nylon straps, very lightweight, and they're just looped around the battery pack, but they're cast in the plastic now, so they can't come loose ever. And you can kind of pick it up. But I found these handles. Here's one. On eBay, these are kind of military chest handles like you have on an ammo box. They're made by a company called Monroe, and they've made them for years, and they're sort of spring-loaded and very heavy-duty. They kind of recess, so we had to cut some holes and recess these in here, silicone this and put some screws and stuck it down here. And here is our button and our meter. Jamie just changed the button. This is our third button we've had on that box because I keep getting plastic in it. But we wind up with a box. Now, this was supposed to be painted black truck liner. Truck bread liner has a pattern to it. It kind of hides our weld marks and so forth. We really like truck liner on our battery boxes.
Oh, yeah.
You have to use Purol Acid number 8 aluminum primer to get paint to stick to aluminum. Now, that's been my experience. We've tried other things. If you remember, Jesse on Speedster Tokyo Nippon decided he didn't need to do that. And he shot the box out here in the driveway. It's nasty smelling stuff. Looked beautiful. Put it in the car, bolted it all down, put the batteries in, and went home. It didn't even peel off. We found it in the floor the next morning. It actually crawled off the box, out of the car, and into the floor. This time, Shane decided he knew better than I did. And he decided that Rust-Oleum primer for metals was just the thing. Probably better, really, than Purol Acid number 8. So he did all that, and he was very proud to show me that it stuck just fine. I stuck a fingernail under the edge and peeled off about half of it in one smooth move.
Damn.
And his face, his little face just fell. Told him he was going to have to get the rest of it off of there, and he thought he was in for a bad afternoon. It took him 10 minutes because it wasn't stuck to it. Poor old acid 8. Acid number 8 is an aluminum primer. There may be other things that work. I haven't found them. I'm not that knowledgeable about painting and metals and so forth. I know that one works. Mm-hmm. You can spray it on, you can brush it on, you can do anything you want. It's better if you're a little scuffed up, but it doesn't matter. An acid etches the aluminum and provides a primer finish
yep.
that sticks to the aluminum. Now you can put something on the primer, it'll stick to the primer, and it'll wear for years that way. So this will eventually be our black crinkle finish, like we always do with the rocket spray-on bed liner, and black with the zinc chromate colored handles that will make it easy to put it into a golf cart or pull it out. Won't make it easy. It's still 100 pounds. This is 17 cells. Recall we were going to try to mate to the golf cart chargers. And that didn't work out very well. And so I've ordered some small chargers from China that'll be perfect for 16 cell packs. 16 cell pack gives us, I've got 53.8 volts here. That's every cell is about 3.36. That's pretty fully charged. And when we're completely discharged or pretty nearly at 3 volts times 16, it'd be 48 volts. So we're gonna call it a 48 volt battery module. But it's empty at 48, and it really starts at, about 54, 53.8. And so that's our lithium module. It's going to be externally pretty tough stuff. We've given up quite a bit of weight here. 16 of these 60 amp hours would be 4.5 pounds times 16 is 40, 64, and 8 is 72 pounds. We've got about 28 pounds of meter and button and can and handle and cable and so forth. We did put a couple of gland nuts on the end. I had some nice metal ones I put on here. We'll probably normally use the polyvinyl black ones. And a couple of cables. We haven't decided what to put on the end of them yet. Of course, traditionally you use the Anderson connector, which I always don't like. Of course, I don't like any of the connectors. You know what I like? The only connector I've really ever even kind of warmed up to a little bit, it's called a Tweeco. It's a welding connector with a cam lock. And you can't get positive and negative confused because they're different cam locks.
Yeah.
And you can't, I mean, it's face-to-face brass, and when you come on down, that cam locks that, and your hands are on plastic, of course. And so it's a pretty safe connector, and it'll carry a lot of current. It's made for welding. We may do something like that. Maybe we'll steal the design and do a miniature Tweeco. I haven't seen those, but I'd like to see a Tweeco about that long. You know, that's a little lighter weight, but would have the same cam type action. And it's been around so long, I'm sure the patent's expired. In fact, there's a lot of Tweeco knockoffs now because it has expired. You only get 17 years, guys. And but that's kind of our approach on a battery module now. I've been looking at boats and golf carts and neighborhood electric vehicles, and there's actually a lot of applications that a good solid lithium module would work with. Unfortunately, we're going to have to provide a charger with it to keep them from overcharging the batteries, or in some cases not being able to charge them with their existing chargers. Mm-hmm. I don't see much of a way around that. No BMS. We are thoroughly bottom balanced, and it's not too hard to do 16 60s. I understand you've been doing some 100s in larger quantities. How's that coming?
Yeah, still in the process.
Mm-hmm. Is that kind of a long hair day?
It's a long day. It's training, but it's good.
Well, I'm glad you're learning to do that. It's coming out. It's kind of all over the world. People are adopting this, and it's working for them.
Yep.
And it's working over and over.
I like Jamie in the white coat there. He's looking fairly professorial.
Dr. Igor.
Oh, is that Igor here? Or Igor.
Yeah, Igor. Sidekick. Actually, it was his idea to flip the box upside down and do it different.
Yeah.
And I found these handles.
Those are pretty cool.
Cargo handles, and put them on it. And so we're gradually moving toward a design that I think I'll like. I want to be able to instantly tell what the voltage of the battery is in digital. I want it to be where you can fire bullets into this module.
Right.
You can't hurt these batteries. I'm going to have it where you can't over-discharge them and hurt them because they're going to be zero balanced at bottom balanced to the uttermost farthing. and then sealed where you can't put a parasitic load on it.
You can
access the two ends, but that's it.
Right.
That's all the button and the meter get to access. No one, you can't with a drill be able to get to any of the terminals to do any of this. And so the remaining thing is don't overcharge them. And we're probably just going to provide the charger with the device. And so that's kind of the plan, and I think it's going to be a lifetime battery that you can intentionally try to abuse.
Yeah, have at it.
If you use my charger on it, and you can run it to zero, we've got enough experience now bringing them back, they'll come back.
Yep, exactly.
Because these are bottom balanced, and you can't really throw them out because you can't get to the terminals to do so. I can't get to the terminals to do so.
No.
Whatever balance they're at for a long time.
That's exactly it. Yeah.
Because, but it does wind up being 100 pounds of battery. But this 48 volt, I think, is a handy size. Probably not for an electric car. Of course, we got too much plastic and metal and stuff. 48 volts, but for a portable battery that you would want to be able to put in a golf cart or take on a fishing boat with a trolling motor,
sure,
that sort of thing. There's a lot of uses for a 48 volt power supply.
Yes, yeah.
And then we have our new solar panels that might be used to charge it, and I think we're getting to some very interesting things. Our solar installation scheduled for October 21st, so be there or be square.
There you go.
We're going to try to get that off the ground, and we're going to start doing some more things about solar and hopefully tying them in with batteries, battery modules, chargers, inverters, and some of the things that we can pull out of the grass to make an electric car or boat basically run on sunlight.
Nice.
And stay with us. We'll be back next week.
All right, we'll see you next week.
For more Underdog Adventures. Don't touch that dial.
There's the music.
There's the music. I need Paulo's music.
Yeah.